In this class, we are going to continue our discussion on scheduling YCPM and PERT. In the last class, we had understood the basics of network and their basic components. We studied the definition of activity, event, predecessor event, successor event, dummy activity, and Fulkerson's rule of numbering the events. Now we are going to study about critical path networks, CPM, critical path method. This is also sometimes known as critical path network or critical path method, but critical path is more important. So in critical path analysis, the basic objective is to estimate the total project duration and to assign a starting and finishing time to all the activities involved in the project. What does it mean? A project consists of many activities, and we have to assign the starting time and finishing time of all those activities which are involved in this project. And also, we have also to determine the project completion schedule, means what is the minimum time required to complete the project. This actually helps in checking actual progress report, progress against the schedule duration of the project. Because you will be knowing that normally no project is completed on time. Only a few projects are completed either ahead of schedule or on time. So projects get delayed. So until we know the project completion schedule, we cannot understand by what time this project has been delayed. So to know the actual progress against the scheduled duration of the project, we need to assign a starting and finishing time to all the activities. To achieve this objective, we need to compute total duration needed for completion of the project and categorization of the activities of the project as being critical and non-critical. I will explain to you what are the critical activities and non-critical activities. An activity in a network diagram is said to be critical if it is delayed, then it will delay the entire project duration. So even if a single activity is delayed for a single day, the project will be delayed. So such activities which are so critical, why are they known critical? Because they are critical in the sense that even if they are delayed, even a single activity on that route is delayed, the entire project gets delayed. So an activity in a network diagram is said to be critical if the delay in it starts, then the entire project completion is delayed. On the contrary, a non-critical activity allows some scheduling slack so that the start time of the activity may be advanced or delayed within limits. without affecting the overall completion date of the entire project. Are you clear? Means there are certain activities on the project schedule which, if delayed for some time, are not going to affect the overall completion of the schedule. This delay has to be, of course, within limits. But if they are delayed within limits, they are not going to affect the project schedule, overall completion period of the project. So these activities are known as non-critical activities. So let us now understand these terms. Earliest occurrence time of event I, this is known as EI. Earliest finish time, or say now you say EI is the earliest occurrence time, and LJ is the latest occurrence time of event J. EI is the earliest occurrence time of event I, and LJ is the latest occurrence time of event J. And in between that, Tij is the duration of the activity Ij. So the critical path calculations are done either by forward pass calculation or backward pass calculation. So let me explain to you first the forward pass calculation. When we start from initial event, initial node 0 or 1, whatever you have named it, with a starting time of the project at 0, means we consider starting time at 0, and if you proceed through the network visiting nodes in an increasing order of node number and end at the final node by the network, this is known as forward pass calculation. At each node, we calculate earliest start and finish time of each activity by considering EI as the earliest occurrence time of node I. So say, first step is EI is equal to 0, that is I is equal to 1 in initial node. So we set the earliest time, earliest start time for each activity that begins at node I as earliest start time ESIJ is equal to EI for all activities IJ that starts at node I. And then third step is we compute the earliest finish time of each activity that begins at node I by adding the earliest start time of the activity to the duration of that activity, which I have said Tij. So say earliest finish time of the activity Ij will be equal to Esij plus Tij. Now we move to the next node, say node J. And then compute the earliest occurrence for node J using Ej is equal to for all immediate predecessor activities. J is equal to final node. Then the earliest finish time for the project is given by En is equal to maximum of EFij is equal to maximum of En minus 1 plus Tij. I will explain with this example. I am just explaining you the theory, and then this will be explained through one example. Then comes backward pass calculation. In the backward pass calculation, we start from the end activity, from the last event, and then proceed through the network, visiting nodes in the decreasing order of node numbers, and end at the initial node, node number 1 or 0. At each node, we calculate the list finish and start times for each activity by considering LJ as the latest occurrence time of node J. So LN is equal to EN for J is equal to N, and latest finish time of each activity that ends at node J will be LFIJ is equal to TJ. Then in the third step, we compute the latest occurrence time of all activities ending at J by subtracting the duration of each activity from the latest finish time of the activity. So latest finish time LSIJ is equal to LFIJ minus TIJ, means LJ minus TIJ. In the step 4, we proceed backward to the node in the sequence that decreases J by 1. We also compute the latest occurrence time of each node I is less than J using the formula LJ is equal to minimum of J LSIJ or minimum of J LJ minus TIJ. If J is equal to 1 in one minute initial load, then LI is equal to minimum of LSIJ, that is equal to minimum of LJ minus TIJ. Based on the above calculations, an activity IJ will be critical if it satisfies what? EI is equal to LJ and EJ is equal to LJ. EJ minus EI is equal to LJ minus LI is equal to TIJ. An activity that does not satisfy the above conditions is termed as non-critical. So we have understood the critical and non-critical activity. Then critical path. What is a critical path? The critical activities of a network that constitutes an uninterrupted path which spans the entire network from start to finish is known as the critical path. So critical path will comprise of all critical activities and will be the most time consuming. It is the longest path. Now, let me explain to you the floats or slack of an activity and event. The word float and slack are synonymously used. The float of an activity is the amount of time by which it is possible to delay its completion time without affecting the total project completion time. Means if you an activity is delayed by say 2 days and the overall project completion is not delayed by delaying a particular activity by 2 days, then this 2 days is known as the float or slack of that activity. So event float is there could be event float or activity float. Event float is LI minus EI, latest start time minus earliest start time, LI minus EI. So this is a measure of how much later than expected a particular event could occur without delaying the completion of the entire project. Then what is activity float? It is the float in the activity time which activity could be delayed by this period. So normally, there are 3 kinds of floats. Number 1 is the total float. Total float of an activity represents the amount of time by which an activity can be delayed without delay in the project completion date. In other words, it refers to the amount of the free time associated with an activity which can be used either before, during, or after the performance of the activity. So total float is the positive difference between the earliest finish time and the latest finish time, or the positive difference between the earliest start time and the latest start time and of an activity, depending upon which way it is defined, either forward method or backward pass method. Then it is free float. The free float is that portion of the total float within which an activity can be manipulated without affecting the float of the subsequent activities. It is computed for an activity by subtracting head event slack from its total float. The head event slack is the difference between the latest and the earliest event type of that particular activity. Then comes independent float. It is that portion of the total float within which an activity can be delayed for a start without affecting floats of preceding activities, without affecting the float of preceding activities. It is computed by subtracting tail event slack from the free float of the activity. If the result is negative, it is then taken as zero. So independent float sometimes comes as negative, then it is considered as zero. So now let us consider an activity in example one of a certain network. Activity is 1, 2. E1 is equal to 20. T12 means time, Tij, what you say Tij. So T12 is equal to 19. So E2 is equal to 39. So earliest start time is 20 days from the zero date. Zero date means the start of first activity. Start of first activity is known as zero date. So from the zero date, it is the 20th day when activity 1, 2 can be started at the earliest, or node E1 can start. Node E2 will complete on 39th day because activity 1, 2 takes 19 days. And it is said that latest start time of event 1 is 30th day and Tij is equal to T12 is equal to 19 days. So latest finish time of activity 2 is 57 days. Then total float is how much? Total float is the latest start of the second event minus earliest start of the first plus duration of this activity 1, 2. So 57 minus 20, 57 minus 20 plus 19. So 18 days is the total float. Free float will be equal to, what did I say about free float? It is that portion of the total float within which an activity can be manipulated without affecting the float of a subsequent activity. So this is E2 minus, this is E2. It would earliest start up activity this minus E1 plus T12. It earliest start of E2 will be earliest finish of 2. So that is equal to 39 minus earliest start of 1 first activity. That is 20 plus the TIA, time of completion of activity 1, 2, 20 plus 9, 39. So 39 minus 39, 0 means it does not have any free flow. Because if you are delaying here, then it will reduce the float of the subsequent activity, successor activity. So E2 minus E1 plus T12, if this has some value, it means this activity can be delayed by this time without affecting the slack or float of the subsequent activity. Now let us consider the independent float. Independent float means within which an activity can be delayed for a start without affecting floats of preceding activity. So independent float will be equal to E2. This E2 is equal to 39 minus L1 minus, sorry, minus L2, L2 plus T12. Latest start of this activity plus this activity duration, if we deduct this from the earliest start time of the successor event, then it comes to 39 minus 38 plus 19, that is minus 18. So in this case, we can, when the minus value comes, we said that this should be considered as zero, so independent float is equal to zero. So normally, slack and float are interchangeably used. We use this terminology synonymously, but slack is generally used for events and float is used for activity. And the difference between the total float and free float is known as interference float. And an activity is critical if its total float is zero. If total float, not independent or free float, if the total float is zero, then the activity is considered as critical, otherwise it is non-critical. So now we consider one problem. Say an activity is comprises of so many, a project is comprises of so many tasks A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, and its duration is given this. Its precedence relationship, so which will occur when, say that A, W precedes X, means Y, W precedes X, Y, suppose, it means what? X and Y cannot start until W is completed. And X, Y precedes W means we cannot start W until both X and Y are completed. So with this understanding, say here if we say A precedes D means D cannot start until A is completed. D and E both. So D and E cannot start until A is completed. B and D must be completed before F is completed. G cannot start until C is completed. H cannot start until B and G are completed. And I cannot start until F and G are completed. So with this, we draw the network. So this is the first network. We can keep it zero or one, both. So this is, say, first activity. Then From A, there are two tasks. B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. Then it says that D cannot be completed until A is completed. D and E both. So, say D and E both cannot be completed until A is completed. So say this activity is A, A is, this activity is A. Once A is completed, then only D will be completed, E will be completed. This D and this E will be completed only when A is completed. So I have said this. F cannot be completed until B and D are completed. So say this is F and this is B. So B and D both must complete. So B and D must complete before F is completed. So B and D precede F. So B and D, once completed, then F is completed. Then F starts. This is the activity. C precedes D. So C precedes G. So say G, this is G. So C precedes G. G and B both. G and B both. So say G and B both. Now C precedes G and B. C precedes G and B both. No, C precedes only G. C precedes G. C precedes G. Huh? Yes. And B and G precedes H. B and G both precede H. So now here we use a dummy to show that B and G both precede H. F and G proceed I. This F and G, this G, both proceed I here. And G, H precedes G, so H precedes G, so that also we have written. So this is the network diagram. Now, to determine the minimum time of completion of the project or critical path, we compute earliest start and earliest finish time of each activity, means EJ and EI, for each event or task IJ of the project. So these critical path calculations are shown here. So let us set E1 is equal to 0, because 0 time, starting time is 0. We'll let this one E1 is equal to 0. Then E2, this E2 will be E1 plus T12. So 0 plus E12 is equal to 20 days. So 0 plus 20, 20 days. Node 3, this is the node 3. E3 will be equal to E1 plus T13. E1 is this one, E1 is equal to 0 plus 13. 13 is equal to 23 days, so 0 plus 23 is equal to 23. Node 4 will be equal to E4, will be maximum of, there are two routes here, one is 1-4 and another is 1-3-3-4. So maximum of this, so this way, this is 23 plus 16, 39, and this is 8. So this will be 39. So note 4, E1 maximum of E1 plus T14. E1 plus TI4. So it will be E1 is equal to 0 plus 8. This is 1. Another is 23 plus 16, 39. So it will be 39 here, maximum of this. Node 5. This is the node 5. Because node 4, we have known that earliest start is 39. So 39 plus what? This is 18. E5 is equal to maximum of EI plus T15. E5. This one E5. It's equal to maximum of what? 2 and 4. Maximum of 2, node 5, see node 5 is equal to E5, E5 is your this one, you can reach here through this route or through this route. If you go through this route, then it will be 20 plus 90, 39 days, and if you go through this route, it will be 8 plus 0, so 8 days, so this will be 39. Node 5 will be 39 days. Node 6, this is your node 6. Node 6 we can reach by either this 20 plus 9, 39 plus this 0, 39 days. Or maximum is this one, or this one will be, this is actually 39 days, and another is this one. This is this 1-4 was, node 4 was 39 plus this is 18, 57. So maximum of these two is equal to 57. So this becomes 57 days, and node 7 will be, node 7 will be maximum of three routes. One route is 1, 2, 3, this route. Another is 1, 2, 3, this route. Another is this route. From this route, it is 20 plus 19, 13 plus 20 plus 19, 39 plus 4. So this is 43. If you go this route, then this is 39. Here it is 39 plus 18. 57 plus 10, 67. Another is this one, 23 plus 24, that is equal to 47. So maximum of this comes, this one, 1, 4, 5, and 7, that is 67 days. So this is the forward calculation, forward pass calculation. So 67 days is the longest time. If you go from by backward calculation, so node 7, node 7, this one, node 7, node 7, node 7 is your 67. So node 7, I will say this it here. Node 7 is your 67. So this L6 will be, this L6, I am calculating this L6. 67 minus T67. This is 10 days, so this will be node 6 will be 57. See, node, it is shown here, node 6 will be 57. I will show this table. So after some time, let me show you the calculation, explain you the calculation here itself. Then node 5 will be node 5. So node 5 from here you can come right from this way, or this you can come this way. So that will be minimum of LJ minus T5J. So 57. This is 57 minus this 0 is equal to 57. This was 57, then minus 0, 57. This is 1. Or minimum of that, this is 67 minus 4 days, 63. So minimum of this is 57, so this will be 57. Node 4, this one will be minimum of LJ minus T4J. LJ is equal to, if you consider LJ is equal to 5, then minimum of L5 minus T4-5. Or if you consider LJ as 6, then this will be L6 minus T4-6. See, L6 minus T4-6, then it will be, or this L5 minus this. L5 was your 57, so 57 minus 0 is equal to 57. And if you say L6, then it was 67 minus 4, then 63. So minimum of this is 57, so this will be 57. Node 3 will be, again, minimum of L4 minus T34, or L7 minus T37. So node 3, L7 minus this 37, 24 days, 67 minus 24. 43 days, or this one 39 minus 16, so that is 23 days. So node 3 is equal to 23 days. Node 2 is simply 57 minus 19 is equal to 38 days. And node 1 will be minimum of this, minimum of this, or this. So this will be L2 minus T12, L4 minus T14, or L3 minus 13. So 38 minus 20, or 23 minus 23, or 39 minus 8. Minimum of this is 23 minus 23 is equal to 0. So by backward calculation, we get that this is the starting node 1 is equal to 0. So all these values have been shown here. 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, duration and earliest start time, earliest finish time, latest start time, latest finish time. And then we have calculated the total float, free float and independent float also. This is all the calculations have been shown here. And the same thing has been shown on this network diagram. Earliest start, latest start. So everything is shown here. So it is clear from the figure that the critical path comprises of which task? 1, 1, 3, 4, 6, and then 7. 1, 3, 4, 6, 7. This is the longest path, and it comprises is of how many days? 67 days. So any activity on this 1, 3, 4, 6, 7 cannot be delayed. If it is delayed, then the entire project gets delayed. On other activities, we have some floats. These floats could be used to delay the activity without affecting the project schedule. So this is the advantage of float calculation, that in those activities, because these are the activities on non-critical path, so if these activities are delayed for some time within limits, then the project does not get delayed. So this is the total calculation that I have shown you. Next class we shall discuss some more things. More points. Particularly, we shall discuss part, ERT part. So we stop it here today.